Shift from focusing on what you are getting and focus only on what you are giving. Because happiness means to be a giver.
Our next speaker is coming from India, and she is extraordinary. She's an example in my mind of love and strength. Some people have love but not enough strength to actually break through. Some people are just strength without the love. She uses truth to cut through the BS and bring people to a deeper level. And I think you're gonna love her. Name is Sister Shivani.
Sister Shivani, it's such a privilege to have you here.
Namaste.
Namaste.
Namaskar.
Namaste.
Om Shanti and greetings of peace, love and happiness from India. First and foremost, I must thank each one of you for coming together just so that you can raise your internal vibration. Because when you come together like this, introspect, reflect, take personal responsibility, and create a shift. When you create a shift within, you're not creating a shift just within. You are creating a shift in the collective consciousness of the planet. Like the room where you are right now, it's vibrating with the energy, which is the energy of each one of your minds. Similarly, the world, the planet, for the last 2 years, has been vibrating with fear and anxiety. And that fear and anxiety has taken a toll on millions of minds. We all knew about the virus pandemic, but there was another pandemic going on for over 2 years, and that was fear and anxiety spreading very fast all over the planet. And now, when you come together like this to release not just fear of 2 years, but release fear, release guilt, release any uncomfortable emotion you've been holding on to, probably since childhood, sometimes from even before that. And when we release any uncomfortable emotion, we raise our vibration. And when we raise our vibration, we're radiating a higher vibration into the energy of the planet, not just the energy of the room where you are, not just the energy of the country where you are, but into the energy of the planet, and thereby shift the vibration of the planet. And this higher vibration is going to touch someone somewhere, and they're going to feel better. And they won't know why they are feeling better, why they are feeling lighter, from where are they experiencing this strength which has come to them, but it's traveled from you into that consciousness of the planet. So really, really, really thank you to each one of you for taking out this time to create a shift in the world. Let's take a minute of silence. It's been a very interesting day for you. I heard about it and I saw you right now, very energetic, very vibrant, very excited. And now the human mind has the power to shift from being excited and energetic to suddenly going into deep silence, absolute silence. So just take a minute. It's just for a minute. Close your eyes if you want. If you want to keep it open, it's fine. Just take this minute for yourself to shift your attention from everything that you see, to shift your attention to what cannot be seen, but what can be felt, and that is our feelings. Happiness is my nature. Happiness is who I am. Happiness and love is what I radiate to everyone. I am a happy being. I am a loveful soul, powerful and divine. Let me just check in any corner of my mind, or even deep, deep, deep layers of my subconscious. Do I still hold any person, past of my life, anything which I still believe is the cause of my emotional hurt? Scan the mind. Check. It could be recent. It could be very old. It could be brushed aside, but it's still there deep. Is there anything I still believe is the cause of any kind of emotional pain? Something that happened, something that someone was responsible for. A mistake they made, or a mistake I made. Do I still, in a very subtle way, still blame someone for my hurt, for the rejection I feel? Or the insult I experienced? And today, I'm certain that I'm going to release them from my mind and shift them from not a painful past, but from a present and a future full of love and blessings. Because I am a powerful being. What I feel is not because of what they did. What I feel is because of what I think about what they did. My feelings are not about them. It's about how I choose to think about them. And I choose forgiveness. I choose acceptance. I choose love, because that is truly my nature. It's who I am. It's the vibration at which I live my life. Because that's where true happiness is. Thank you so much. And you can gently come back into the present, keeping the vibration the same. And just reflecting. The only one thing that we need to be happy always. Happy, we all are. But the word to be underlined is always. Always. And always means when situations are not favorable, when people are not my way, and when people are completely opposite to what I expected them to be. And when someone does something which I never ever imagined could happen with me. So irrespective of what situations and people, the energy that they throw towards me, I only need to remember that their power is outside. Their power is outside. People have the power to say what they believe is right. People have the power to do what they believe is right. And we have the power to think what we believe is right. So the only one thing that we need to shift today is shift from a life of blame to a life of personal responsibility. And blame, not only in these specific situations, but we live a life of blame often during the day. If someone had to ask us right now, who is the creator of your thoughts and feelings? It wouldn't even take a second. And we would say, obviously, it's me. I create my every thought, my feeling. Who's that I? That I is the energy, which we call light, power, consciousness, soul, spirit. Words are many. Important is the understanding. I am this energy, the creator of every thought, feeling, and emotion. It's something that I need to affirm many, many times in the day. I am the creator of my every thought, feeling, word, and behavior. I am the creator. And then gently shift my mind to a different vocabulary. So instead of saying, I'm stressed because of, I'm upset because of, I'm happy because of, I'm angry because of, I'm hurt because of, all the because of has to fall off because it's not because of anybody. I am what I am because I choose to be that way. Yes, the stimulus is there. Sometimes it's a very beautiful, pleasant stimulus, and sometimes the opposite. But I choose how to be in the face of that stimulus. It sounds very simple because it is very simple. And right now, we understand it, we accept it, we live it. But we need to live it in those situations during the day where our mind is speaking this old vocabulary, I'm feeling like this because of. I only need to change this line. Even saying something like, the first thing that I need when I wake up is my cup of coffee. Fine, have your cup of coffee. But change the vocabulary which says, I cannot live without my morning cup of coffee. That line makes me dependent on a cup of coffee. I choose to have a cup of coffee. I cannot say I cannot live without my morning coffee. See the difference in the vocabulary. One makes me a master and the other makes me dependent on that cup of coffee. Then it's no more a cup of coffee after that. Then I will have something else for which I will say, I cannot live without this. I cannot do without this. Every time I'm using this vocabulary, I'm saying my mind is dependent on situations, people, objects, substances. And that is what makes me a victim. A victim where my happiness, my love, my peace, my power is not mine. It's dependent. Because I've said it so many times during the day, I'm dependent, I'm dependent. So just one shift today, just one shift is going to shift everything else. Just from today, very subtle. Even if you say it, stop it and say it again. I choose to do this. Not I cannot live without this. I cannot do without this. No, I am a master. I am the master of my mind. I am the master of my sense organs, and I choose what to do. Once we start practicing this, it will become a natural way of living. It becomes a natural way of living. Then we take it to the next level. I create the stress that I'm experiencing right now. It's not work stress. It's not relationship stress. It's not travel stress. It is I create the stress. Work, relationship, travel, exams, these are pressures. So again, keeping the simple formula with you, stress is equal to pressure divided by resilience. We used to learn this in school. Stress is equal to pressure divided by resilience. Pressure is not in my control. Pressure could be a behavior, pressure could be the weather, pressure could be COVID, pressure could be the current situations in the world, pressure could even be the health of my body, because it's my body, again, outside to who I am. I am the being, this is my body. So pressure, which means challenge in life, sometimes could be the health of my body. But we cannot say, because I'm not healthy, I'm not happy. No. It's not matter over mind. It is mind over matter. Body may be unwell. Body may be experiencing a terminal illness. And I can be calm and happy because my mind is not dependent on my body. This is the truth. This is a reality. And we've seen everyone around us. Many of you must have met someone who's going through a chronic ailment and yet very light, vibrant, happy. And someone could just have a little cold, cough, fever, and they say, oh, I'm not well, what to do, horrible day, bitter experience. They can blame just a little cold for not being happy that day. People open the windows in the morning and say, the weather is so depressive. He can't say that. Then I'm saying I'm feeling low and gloomy because of the weather. This is very subtle, but it's become our vocabulary. And the more we speak that way, the more the mind becomes dependent. So what is happiness? Happiness means being emotionally independent. Emotionally independent. Physical independence, social independence, financial independence, emotional independence. That is power. Emotional independence is power, which means I am emotionally independent, calm in a crisis, loveful when someone is in pain and not behaving the right way with me, respectful and radiating blessings when someone could be using abusive language because they are emotionally unwell right now. When someone is not in their right behavior, we need to remember they are not doing this to us. They're only showing us their state of mind at the moment. They're just showing us that they are emotionally in pain. And so their words, their behavior, their energy, it reflects their pain. Their pain could be just as words, and sometimes it could be more than that. Recently, a young sister, about 30, 35 years old, she came to learn meditation at the center. And she was sitting in the meditation room, and when she walked out, she just said, I've released something that I've held on to for almost 30 years. I said, what happened? And then she shared that she had gone through an experience when she was 5 years old. Her parents had left the house with her uncle. She was 5 years old that time, and she experienced abuse. And now she was about 35, and she said, you know what? 35 years I have hated people. I can't trust people. She chose not to get married, not to be in a relationship. And she said, I can't trust anybody. And she said, I don't even trust my parents, actually. And she said, I've not had a very good relationship with them for 30 years. And she said, while I was sitting and contemplating what we have studied today, she said, I just realized that what I experienced 30 years back was somebody else's mistake. But all that they could do was to my body, which was horrible. But you know, what did I do for 30 years to myself? She said, I held on to hatred for 30 years. I held on to doubt and insecurity for 30 years. She said, what they did was bad, but I think what I did to myself was completely my choice. And today, she said, today I release. I just release what I've held on to because I realize what I've held on to is not what they did. What they did was to my body, but what I held on to was my creation. And I'm not going to live in hurt and pain anymore. That's all. It was just that. 1 minute of a realization. And that doesn't mean what the other person did was right, not at all. But what it just means is what I was creating here was my choice. What they did was not in my control at that age. But what I did for 30 years was completely my choice, and I chose to create hatred. And she changed her vocabulary immediately. She said, I chose to create hatred. Before that, she was saying, people are horrible. See the shift in the vocabulary. I chose hatred. She said, I chose not to forgive. She said, I chose not to like my parents and blame them for what happened. And then when she started this healing with herself, and healing was just an understanding, her relationships with her parents changed because she had released that emotional blockage which she had held on to for so long. And when she did that, she suddenly shifted towards being happy. Earlier, she was doing everything the normal way, working. She's not innately happy because I cannot be happy when I've held on to something there in my subconscious. I just cannot be happy. So it's a very fundamental thing. I think we should have been taught this when we were in kindergarten. It's very fundamental that people can be here, they can cheat, they can betray, they can abuse, they can use wrong language, but that's because they are emotionally unwell. It's because they are going through something very turbulent inside them. But my thought and feeling, my emotion is my choice. It's my creation. And I choose to be empathetic. I choose to be compassionate. And in most cases, I choose to even forgive. Forgive. Because actually, I'm not forgiving them. You know, we say, how can I forgive someone who's done this? But we are not actually forgiving them. The law of karma. We all know the law of karma. Law of karma means anything that I have done will always have a consequence in my life. Law of karma works with every soul. And if someone has wronged me, my saying I forgive them doesn't mean law of karma is not working with them. Law of karma is working with us always. But when I say I forgive, I'm actually forgiving myself. I cannot forgive their karmic consequence. I cannot. Even if the whole world says we forgive them, their karma consequence will always be there with them. But when we say, I forgive, it actually means I forgive myself by releasing this hatred, hurt, and pain that I have held on to. So there's only one person we can forgive. We cannot forgive anybody else. There's only one person, and that's me. So when we say, I cannot forgive somebody, and even if I forgive, I cannot forget what they did. What does it mean to forget what someone has done? Obviously, we won't forget the incident. We know what had happened. We know what somebody had done. So it's not that I forget the incident, but I forgive, I forget means it doesn't hurt anymore. That's all it means. It's like a physical wound. When we were children, cycle, bicycle, falling, we injured ourselves. Small wounds, big wounds, some wounds healed. And because they healed, we don't even remember when they happened. But some scars are still visible on the body. And every time we see the scar, we can remember what happened. Similarly for the mind, if I heal myself, It's over. It's over. But if I hold it as a scar and say, no, I cannot forgive them, then not only I cannot forgive, I can never forget what happened. Now, how do and why should I forgive someone? Why should I release what has happened? Why should I relieve myself from that emotional pain that I'm holding on to? Because it will never allow me to be happy. It will keep me at a lower vibrational energy. And when I am at a lower vibrational energy, then my ability to respond right into my day-to-day living also starts getting affected. We are all a vibrational energy. We can be anywhere from, let's say, hypothetical words, but from 10 to 100. We have the ability to go up to divinity. We have the ability to go up to purity. But we're choosing to live here only because they did what they did. Just because they made a mistake, I should choose for the rest of my life to live at a lower vibration? No, not at all. Not at all. And when I choose to live that way, it stays in my aura. It's in my energy field. And everywhere I'm moving, it's my aura, my energy field that walks with me. It's moving with me. It's radiating from me to people. What am I radiating out to people? Hurt that I created because of their mistake? No. No one and no one's mistake is that big that I will spoil the rest of my life by keeping them here. So all that I need to do is, for a few days, I create that releasing process. I need to teach my mind how to think right. When it happened? What we said that day was, I'll never forgive them. I can never forget what they did. I will never talk to them again. We gave very strong instructions to our mind. If someone had to ask you, what did you have for breakfast yesterday? We'll have to think for a few minutes. What did I have for breakfast yesterday? And even then you might not remember. But if someone had to ask you, what did they do that time? You will know it, every specific instruction, everything, what they were wearing, where they were standing, how they were looking, what they were saying, everything. Why is it that I don't remember what happened yesterday and I remember what happened many years back? Because when it happened, I told my mind, I will never forget what they did. That's it. And my mind is my best friend. I'm the master of this mind. My mind follows my every instruction. So tell your mind, I'll never forget and it never will forget. And from today, just tell your mind, it's over. It's a past. It's over. I'm not taking it into my present. I release it. I let it go. And just within a few days, it's so simple. Even physical wounds take longer to heal. Emotional wounds, very easy because it's only a thought. It's only an instruction. It's we who held on to it by thinking about it, by talking about it, by going and sharing with everybody. And every time we repeated it, the wound only got, because we were scratching it again and again. You know what they did? You know what they did? Do you know what they did? Do you know what they did? And the other person also said, oh, they did this. Oh, they did that. So we are kind of going on reaffirming what they did. We don't need to reaffirm what they did. Because if we reaffirm what they did, the wound only gets deeper. Let's reaffirm who I am. I am a loveful soul. I'm an empathetic soul. I'm a compassionate soul. And I have the ability to release anything, anything, anything. And I forgive only means I release the pain from here. Sometimes there are people with whom we invest a lot in that relationship. A lot of trust, a lot of love, a lot of respect, unconditional. And we visualize it to always be a very beautiful karmic connection. And suddenly everything changes. And the first thing that my mind says, why did they do this to me? Why did this happen to me? And sometimes it happens repeatedly and we say, why does this keep happening with me every time? Is this how my destiny is going to be? The same thing is happening with me again and again, repeatedly. Why does this happen to me? So we need to understand the journey of the soul. When we reflect on our life and on our karma, We only see what we've done in this lifetime. It's very, very important. Without knowing this, we will not be able to answer most of the questions of life. But once we know this, we're able to answer every question of our life. I'm not this body. I took this body one day and I will leave this body one day. Birth and death is going to happen for everybody. But who is it that is born and who is it that leaves? When someone dies, we say they've left. Who's left? The body is there. Who has left? When someone is in the hospital, taken in for a surgery, the doctor says, "Sister, nurse, take Mr. So-and-so inside. In case something goes wrong, the person is no more." The doctor says, "Sister, take the body out." Why the difference in vocabulary? Take Mr. So-and-so inside and take the body out. That means after that, it's only a body. It's only a body. So the master of the body has left. The energy has left. Left and gone where? Energy cannot be destroyed, cannot be created. It's eternal. So I am eternal. So where do I go? So I, the energy, leave the body, take another costume, enter the womb of a mother, and very soon start a new life. Life after life after life after life. It's only a change of costume. It's only a change of costume. Just like you're wearing a dress today, tomorrow morning, new dress. Now, the people who are sitting around you right now, just see them. Tomorrow morning, they will also be in another dress. And you will also be in another dress. Similarly, the people in your lives, when you meet them in this body, they have also changed their bodies. But sometimes we are meeting souls whom we've met before. We're meeting souls whom we've met before. Souls with whom we have very beautiful karmic connections. We've met them before. And souls with whom we have a little, we've met them before. And in our previous meeting, whatever was the karmic exchange, whatever behaviors, words, energies, interactions we had, either soul leave the body, but that karma, that impression carries forward with me. And when two souls meet, and this is something you would have all experienced, sometimes you feel very nice meeting somebody. And you say, they're not related to me. I hardly know them. Why is it I'm feeling so nice meeting this person? It's a past karmic carry forward. You don't recognize them with these eyes, but the soul instantly recognizes them and feels that same energy which the soul has experienced before with them. And with someone, even though they may be immediate family, say, I don't know why we keep having problems with each other. Why we just don't seem to be getting along. I don't know why they have a problem with me. We are all souls on a journey. And it's very important to always remember this. I am a soul on a journey and they are a soul on a journey. And a soul on a journey means many, many karmas, many, many experiences, many, many thought processes, many, many emotional patterns. And when we look at them in this lifetime, we say, my partner, my child, my mother, my sibling. That is just a role we are playing in this lifetime. A soul on a journey. A very pure, loveful soul on a journey. And so I need to remember that if I have some karmic discomfort with somebody in this lifetime, it may not have started in this lifetime. And that's why a lot of people today go through a past life regression to see what had happened in the past. But we don't even need to go through a past life regression to see what had happened in the past. It's really not needed, actually. We don't need to go and find out what happened in the past. We just need to know, what do I have to do now? Because it's the present which is powerful. Past is already done. It's finished. It's over. I can't do anything to the past. But I can change the karmic energy in the present. So the power lies in the present, irrespective of whatever had happened in the past. The power lies in the present, and what I choose to do in the present in terms of my thinking will also decide my future. Because my present is my present karma. It's the present energy I create, and that decides the future. And that's why the world says everything is predestined. No? Doesn't the world say everything is predestined? Which means my destiny is already decided. It's predestined. But predestined by who? Predestined by who? Predestined by me. When I created that karma, I already chose what will happen next with me. So now when I receive an energy from somebody which is not as per my expectations, let me just remember, this is a return energy of something that I had created before. Let me now send the energy which I want to create in this relationship. So shift from focusing on what you are getting and focus only on what you are giving. Because happiness means to be a giver. A giver. A giver not in physical things, but a giver in thoughts, feelings, and emotions. Instead of living a life saying, I need happiness, I need love, I need respect, I need somebody to understand me. We're not like this, needing, seeking, wanting. This is not happiness. Happiness means I give love. I radiate love because I am love. So what I am automatically will radiate from me. It's some belief system somebody taught us when we were kids. We need love from people. No, we don't need love from people. We radiate and give love to people. But then who's going to give me? When I give, it is first I create. So I create and I give, and the first one to experience it is me. So it's very, very important that we are going to settle our past karmic accounts. Something that we created in the past creates a discomfort in the present, but to heal it in the present is very important. Otherwise, it remains as a discomfort in my present. And if I don't heal it before I leave this body, big chances that I carry forward with me. And so forgiveness is very important, because forgiveness means I am changing my present karma. I'm changing my present karma. So forgiveness becomes very, very important. Otherwise, we're carrying a personality of feeling rejected, feeling humiliated, feeling hurt, not created in this lifetime. We've created these emotional patterns before. And we're not aware. And we say, why am I feeling like this? Why do I keep feeling like this? Why repeatedly with me? Repeatedly with me because I'm not changing my past emotional hurt. For us, it is life and death. But for the soul, it is you're in this body, tomorrow in another. So today, if you were dancing or playing or horse riding and you injured yourself, and if you don't heal it, tomorrow you will change your dress, but your injury remains where it is, and it's going to pain you again tomorrow because you didn't heal it while you were in this dress. Similarly, I am in this dress. Someone did something to me. I didn't heal my pain. Tomorrow this dress will change, but I will carry that pain with me. So a lot of personality traits we're carrying from birth, we're carrying from the womb of the mother, and we're probably carrying from the past. So it's time to heal. It's time to heal. So let's create a few affirmations right now for ourselves so that healing and releasing will become very simple for us. Very simple. And then we will start saying these affirmations every morning. Let's keep it as the first thoughts of the morning. And every night before going to sleep. Because these two timings, deep, deep, deep impact on subconscious. And what we are healing is in the subconscious. So during the day, I can say it, but very, very important, first thoughts in the morning and last thought in the night. I am a pure, powerful soul. Purity is my personality. Love and happiness is who I am. I create happy thoughts always. I radiate love and compassion everyone. Past is past. It's over. In case someone, this is not the affirmation, I'm just sharing. In case someone's doing something not right with you and you understand that it's not a present life karma but a carry forward, then first in our minds, we need to say sorry to them for a pain that maybe may have caused earlier, which we don't remember. So we say, I am sorry. I am sorry for what I have done in the past. So we are saying sorry for something we did in a past life. We don't know what we had done, and we don't need to know, but we need to apologize. I'm sorry for what I have done in the past. I forgive you for what you have done in the present. I forgive you for what you have done. Our past karmic account is over. Is over. Which means that past energy that we were exchanging is over. A new beginning. I radiate only love and blessings to you. Because this is who I am. I am the master of my mind. I am the creator of my destiny. That's it. So just these few 7-8 thoughts, we will just need to say them for 10, 15 days, 20 days, 1 month. Depends on how old the wound is, how deep the wound is. Initially, when you say it, you might not feel it, but just say it, because we're just overwriting an earlier thought pattern and we're teaching our mind to think differently. And gently, within 4-5 days, a week, you will start feeling what you are saying, and a few days more, and you will start believing what you are saying. And then the past is over. And what we are doing right now could also be with the soul whom you are not with in the present, which means they may not be a part of your relationship circle right now, but it's something of the past. Even then, we need to settle that negative karmic exchange that was there. It's not necessarily it's with people whom we are with in the present. It could be someone in my childhood. It could be some anything. But I need to settle any uncomfortable karmic energy exchanges so that that karmic account is closed. And whenever we meet again, it's always going to be a beautiful energy exchange. Always. So then we are traveling light here. No baggage. No emotional baggage. In the present, we will not create emotional baggage because we understand we are the creators of our thoughts, but we are releasing past emotional baggage. So we travel light, and light is always happy. It's always pure. And when the moment comes and I, the soul, leave this body, it's going to be with so much ease and dignity. So light, not carrying any burden, not carrying any burden at all. Because I was settling and releasing and cleaning and forgiving while on the journey. While on the journey. So even every night before going to sleep, if there's anything that happened during the day, release, clean, forgive. Before going to bed, every day, release, clean, forgive before going to bed, apologize before going to bed, even if it's just in the mind, because everything is only about thoughts and energies. Release, clean, forgive, apologize, even if you just said a rude word, even if you got irritated, apologize in your mind. It will send healing energy to the other person. Just apologize. I'm sorry for what I did. If you can say it to them, beautiful. If you can't, Just create a thought. Thoughts travel. They reach. I apologize. I'm sorry. And if someone was not right, it's okay. I understand you were in pain. I forgive. So we're cleaning the clutter on the mind every day. Like we clean our bed, we clean our home, we clean our body. We clean our mind every day. And if we clean it every day, there's no baggage that we're carrying. We're traveling light. And traveling light is happy, pure, loveful, and extremely powerful. Extremely powerful. Because your mind becomes very powerful. The mind becomes weak if it's carrying too much baggage, old stuff there. Very subtle. We're not even aware. So it's very simple. Being happy and radiating happiness is the simplest thing to do in life. Thank you so much. And I'm open to whatever you now want to share.
Let's have a hand for Sister Shivani. Yes. Please grab a seat. We'll have a few questions. Sister Shivani, would you share with us how you came to these truths, to the truth that everything is created by our own thoughts, the truth of forgiveness? Because these truths have been known, but not everyone embodies them. So would you share with us a little of your story of how that came to be and how you've come to embody them so deeply?
I got introduced to the Raj Yoga meditation, which I learned at the Brahma Kumaris about 25 years back. And it begins with experimentation. It's not something that I understood immediately. I come from an engineering background, so I was looking at everything very, very logically. But then a scientific background also teaches us to experiment. So I was experimenting with it, experiencing it. And then one day, I was asked to be a part of this TV program, which I did call Awakening. It was not that I was prepared for it. I knew nothing of what will happen. I was just there because somebody was not available that day. And I was kind of literally forced to sit on that chair. And I said, I know nothing what's going to happen. And they just said, just sit. We have to create an episode and send for today. And it just happened. It was like, I don't know. It was just coming out. Whatever I was sharing. But while I was sharing, I was the first one who was learning. Huh. And that's been the journey of the last 15 years. Whatever I'm sharing, it's actually I'm learning first and then using it. And then seeing the result, not just in my life, but have had the fortune, just like both of you, to see the result in so many people's lives. Yes. And when you see a result in so many people's life, you know it. You know it's 100% certain that it works. Yeah. It works always.
We all teach what we most need to learn, right? Yeah. That's beautiful. Thank you for sharing that.
Sister Shivani, it's such a privilege and a gift to have you. So thank you for your presence. I'm curious, so the affirmations they set and they frame the day, and then as well the cleaning, the purification at night, those are both the rituals. Say, for example, if somebody is charged in the moment, if they have discord in the moment, and they're feeling in the heat of it, beyond doing the affirmation, is there anything else that you can do to help to unravel the tension if somebody's experiencing such
if someone's feeling very stuck.
Stuck or frustrated or angry or whatever it might be, or even sadness for that matter. What do you recommend if somebody's actually in the state of the emotion?
Right. First and foremost, there are two options. It's like what to do when I'm unwell. You know, physically, if I'm unwell, what should I do? But second important is also, what should I do on a daily basis so that my immunity system is high and my chances of falling ill are minimal, right? Yes. So I would prefer the other one first. So like we all take care of the body for a good physical immunity system, mm-hmm. and more or less we're leading, having healthy bodies, similarly for emotional immunity system. So I need to build up my emotional immunity system. Mm. So just a few simple lifestyle habits. One is a very good sleep cycle. Mm. A lot of our emotions that we are experiencing today is because we are emotionally fatigued.
Yes.
And that's because we don't give good rest to our mind. You know, like a tired body. If the body is tired, we sometimes get very irritable. So like you've been doing this program and I am understanding that the organizers must be having a late night and they know it's going to happen for 4 or 5 days. They're happy while doing it, but yet body will get tired. And sometimes we can get irritated because we are tired and people will say, it's okay, she's tired, she'll be fine once she's rested. We know that on a physical level, but what do we do with a tired mind? When are we giving it rest? So very important thing for good emotional immunity and health is deep sleep. A lot of us are sleep deprived today.
Yes.
We can doze off to sleep anytime on the flight, even early morning, because we are not experiencing deep sleep. We are sleeping long, but not deep. So it's not about how many hours, it's about the stage of my sleep. So our sleep also should be a meditative sleep. Mm. And for that, the highest energizing time for sleeping is between 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. Never miss out on these 4 hours of sleep. 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. is a high energizing time. And the best waking up time is 4 a.m. to 5 a.m. It's the highest vibrational time of the 24-hour cycle in terms of energy, the 4 a.m. to 5 a.m. time. Now, if when I came here 25 years back, that's the first change that I created in myself, sleeping early, and automatically waking up early. I don't have to do much on the waking up part. Just have to sleep early, have an early dinner, finish your 2 to 2.5 hours of digestion before you go to sleep. So that your body doesn't have to go through digestion during sleep. Second, at least an hour before we go to sleep, we disconnect from work communication and we disconnect from any negative content consumption.
Yes.
So not a single negative word should go on my mind. Actually, take care even during the day, because we're consuming so much of content now. And that's a big cause of our emotional health. It's a cause of our overthinking. It's a cause of our reacting. It's a cause of feeling fearful, sad, upset very easily. It's because we're consuming a lot of that kind of content. Mm. So what we watch, read, listen is who we become.
Yes.
Content is equal to personality, is equal to destiny. So content is someone's business and they're doing well with their business, but we are changing our destinies just because we're consuming that. So restrict content consumption, and definitely any content which has fear, hurt, ridicule, criticism, lust, anger, aggression, it is not entertainment.
Yes.
It is not entertainment. It is toxic for the mind and for the body both. Now, just before going to sleep, 15 minutes consuming pure content, which means that's where spirituality works very well, because it's content which has words of purity, acceptance, compassion, forgiveness. So consuming it just before going to sleep, which means it goes into your subconscious during your sleep. Mm-hmm. So those 15 minutes before the sleep are very important. Take that high nutritional, emotional diet just before going to sleep. Then immediately after waking up, because again, the subconscious is active that time. So meditation in the morning and consuming again pure content in the first 15 minutes of the morning. These two timings are very, very important. Just before going to sleep and just when you wake up. If you nourish yourself with pure, powerful content at these two times, the chances of you becoming vulnerable during the day are minimal.
Yes.
Are minimal, actually, because you are becoming emotionally fit. You know, it's raising our emotional fitness levels, or we say spiritual fitness levels, because we're taking the right diet at the right time. And during the day, restricting negative content consumption. We have enough of our negative to finish. Why should we consume negative from the world? Even something like world news. You know, people feel, oh, it's not just before going to sleep, we are watching the world news. If I keep consuming the world news, my mind will keep becoming what the world is. And if my mind keeps becoming what the world is, the world will keep becoming more of what it is today.
Yes.
I need to become that which can change the world, not just consuming that what is going on in the world. So yes, being informed of what's happening in the world, but not consuming that just before going to sleep or the first thing in the morning. And that is the highest TRP time of news channels, late night and early morning. Yeah. So, you know, it's only about the timing of what we are doing. So emotional diet, exercise for the mind is self-reflection, meditation. Anyone does these two things, they're going to be emotionally very fit. A Another very beautiful thing that we do is we take a pause of 1 minute every hour.
It's beautiful.
It's called just a minute. It's a just a minute meditation.
Yes.
So taking a break of 1 minute, we have apps on the phone. A very beautiful music will play every minute. And we will just sit back, take a minute and reaffirm, I'm pure, I'm powerful. I let go of what happened in the last hour. I'm available and accepting in the next hour. You know, so my mind again gets recoded every hour. Again, it's like how doctors say, move away from the screen, blink your eyes for 20 seconds, get up, take a stretch. Now, this is for the little exercise for the mind. So when these things happen on a daily basis, you're emotionally very fit. In spite of that, if there is a situation and I create pain or I create hurt, first thing that I immediately do is pick up something to read, which means immediately give myself something which is nutritional, immediately. And what is what that is what we call an emotional first aid kit. It should always be there in your bag or your purse,
yes.
A book, a video or audio. It may not be related to your situation, but just consuming pure, powerful words will first give strength to your mind. Mm-hmm. So immediately consume it and then just take a minute. Don't allow your mind to keep crying. Take a minute, sit with yourself and counsel yourself as if you were doing it to a friend.
Yes.
You can write out your thoughts which say, they did this to me. How could this happen to me? Just write out those thoughts. Leave a line blank after every thought. And now write out the next thought, which you would say it to your friend if they were saying this to you. How could they do this to me? Why did they do this to me? People are so horrible. So write out your thought.
Yes.
And then write out a thought which you would share with that one whom you love. And very soon, your mind will know what you're trying to say. And the mind will say, okay, I'm fine. I released and I'm now okay. But mostly I feel that if we take care of our daily lifestyle in building emotional fitness, these times hardly ever come.
Yes, that's beautiful.
They hardly ever come.
Fitness is the difference between that, as you've heard somebody talk about before, emotional intelligence is wonderful. It's a capability, but fitness is a state of readiness. And it's because you're awakening that part of your nervous system throughout the evening, the morning, and perhaps throughout the day. That's beautiful. Thank you for sharing that.
Yes.
You had one more question before we go to the group?
Yes. Sister Shivani, I'm curious of the mindset and practice. A lot of times people feel that if they lose somebody, that it's a grief, you know, that is so difficult to overcome. Is there a practice for an individual if they've currently had somebody that they have lost that connects them in oneness with their beloved? Or is it the recognition that we are all one and I am a soul, they are a soul, and the recognition of the affirming that and going into meditation and that reality to connect in that heart space, whether they are here or not? I'm just curious if you could shed light on that.
Yes.
Especially that of the loss of a child, since that has been one of the people who had the most difficulty.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Need to remember, if we are a family of three or four and we lose one family member, we are in so much pain.
Yes.
But now just think about that soul who has lost everybody. So if I'm a family of four and I lose one family member, the pain is so much, but we are still three together and we lost one. But that one lost all three. That one lost everything they achieved. That one lost their body. So imagine how much pain they are in. You know, we never ever think that the one who experienced death is in pain. Because we feel they are no more. So it means as if it's finished. It's not finished. Only the body is no more.
Yes.
The soul is exactly what they were with you. They can catch your every feeling, your every thought, your every word, even more than what they can catch when they are in a body. It's like out-of-body experience.
Yes.
You can catch every thought and feeling. And then this soul enters into the womb of a mother. And that's why all those mothers just rewind and see how your experience has been during your pregnancy. And if you've had two children, you would have noticed that two times the experience would have been different. Depends on who the soul is who enters and depends on what the energy the soul is receiving from their family.
Yes, interesting.
So one, to remember that we are in pain, yes, but the one who's moved forward is in much, much, much more pain than me. And my responsibility right now is to heal them before they begin their new journey. So it's a priority shift.
Yes.
My priority now is, and especially like you said, child. So parent would do anything for their children, right?
Yes.
So while we were doing it, while they were with us, now what we have to do is even more important than what we were doing when they were with us. They are entering a new body, a new body health, a new destiny is going to start. It needs to start with happiness and love and power and blessings. Mm. They have to be healed before they begin their new journey.
Beautiful.
And most important, when I'm in pain here, my vibrations of pain reach them. And sometimes the pain is like, why did you go away? How do you think I'm going to live without you? You have to come back. My life is of no use without you. What you have done is unfair. So, you know, these thoughts seem so normal, but we are actually complaining to them.
Mm.
We're actually angry with them. If someone comes to your place, it's not about for how long they were. Important is what was the quality of that relationship.
Mm.
So even if somebody was with me for 10 years, let me not complain that why did you go away so soon? Let me radiate gratitude. Thank you for every moment of those beautiful 10 years.
Mm.
Thank you for filling me with so much love and power in 10 years. So, you know, you're saying the farewell with gratitude,
yes,
not with hurt and not being angry, because the other person there will create guilt.
Yes.
The soul will create guilt. I left them. They're unhappy because of me. No, we have to send them with gratitude. We have to send them with blessings. So every morning and night, and of course, any number of times during the day, again, affirmation, I am a powerful soul and you are a very, very powerful soul. Thank you for every moment that you were with us and we know you are still with us. We know you are still with us. And most important, you don't worry about us. We are absolutely fine. We will take care of each other. Don't worry about us. Your new journey, perfect healthy body, happy, loveful mind, and beautiful relationships are your destiny.
Mm-hmm.
You are always with us and we are always with you. We will always remember you with love, love, and only love and blessings. So let's just say this for a few days. Initially, again, we could be crying or hurting while we're saying it.
Yes.
But we are teaching the mind to start thinking another way. And within a few days, the mind will shift. We will always miss them, but miss them with love, not with pain.
Mm.
So just remember that when you're crying, when you're hurting, it's not just you who are in pain, it's they who are receiving the pain. Do I want to send them that? No, I don't want
Yes, absolutely.
Beautiful.
Thank you. It's really lovely.
Some questions from the room? Yes. Emma Grace.
I want to ask you, what do you think about enlightenment? Because I've been reading and listening many people that has been guided through meditation to look for the enlightenment. And the path that you are showing us today is part of the people that is going through that way. So my question is about that. How do you see it?
Enlightenment only means when I awaken from my old way of thinking, which was taking me into pain and darkness, even one change of thought, and you are enlightened.
Yes.
Enlightenment is happening every day because we're always on the journey. Enlightenment is not something that happens once.
100%.
Enlightenment is every single day because when I'm shifting in my energy, in my vibration, I'm shifting towards a higher energy light. So it's a process. It's a journey. It's not a one-off that today I'm enlightened.
Yeah.
It's not like that. It's a gradual, gentle, very beautiful journey. And you enjoy this journey.
Yes. So we are on the way of enlightenment here.
We already are. We're only moving higher.
Yes.
Okay.
We're only moving higher.
Thank you, Shima.
I'm so glad I'm so glad you asked that question, because I know so many people are pursuing enlightenment like they pursue objects of achievement. And that has nothing to do with what enlightenment is. It's every moment. It's not something you're going to arrive at and then it's over. If you do that, you're furthest thing from enlightenment. It's not something you can pay someone to give you or you can get after X number of days. It's something you live every day. There is no other form but that. Couldn't agree with you more, Sister. Yes. Question.
Thank you very much. I really honor your soul and your presence. My question is, what do you recommend for us to exercise, like for the family members, like my father? I love my father. I love him. My soul feels very happy when I see my father. But he's not always surrendered about positive energy. So what do you recommend me? So when I see my father.
You feel he's not surrounded by positive energy?
Yeah, like when I see my father, like his energy, like,
okay.
I can feel the negative energy of him.
Okay. So it's like if your father was physically unwell, what would you do? You would take care of him. Mm. You would heal him. So similarly, if someone you feel is at a slightly lower vibrational energy in their emotions, we radiate those emotions to them. We radiate those feelings to them simply by first being it yourself, mm-hmm. right? So being it yourself. And that's why the principle of taking care of others first begins with self-care.
Amen.
First self-care. So you yourself take care that you've deleted all the negative that you were carrying in your aura and keeping your energy clean every day. So, you know, just being in your presence, even if you're not physically present, but emotionally, your father is connected to you. So he's always receiving your vibrations. And when somebody receives it's like we've all experienced, like you are in this room. You're in a room of a higher vibrational energy. So don't you feel it assists you to move up?
Yes.
Does it help you to shift higher? Similarly, your higher energy will help him to shift higher. You know, we always are able to enable others to shift. But if we don't take care, sometimes we shift other people lower because we were very low. So that's why taking care of your vibration is the first thing. And second, from today, don't create a thought that he's at a negative energy. Yeah. Even that becomes our affirmation. So we will never think that again. We will never say that again. And we will only say he's a pure soul. Mm. Always happy. Always happy, always light, always powerful. And even when you talk to him, you say, you're a very beautiful soul. You're a very beautiful soul. I can feel love and compassion from you. And create a thought that he is surrounded by a divine light energy circle of love and happiness. Visualize that. Mm-hmm. Surrounded by a divine light energy circle of happiness. Just radiate this energy to him. Energy is the easiest we can catch, faster than COVID.
Beautiful.
Charles, faster than COVID.
We love you, Sister Shivani. You're spot on. How about back here?
Whenever you talk, I feel your peacefulness and also how slow you talk about things, because I realize sometimes when I talk, I try to talk super fast so that people can listen to me. But you speak in the way that make me feel maybe it's okay to speak a little bit slower.
Could be more powerful.
Yes, and I have a question, because I've been listening to Tony's material since I was 13 years old in China. Like,
wow.
We have a Chinese version of Tony Robbins' like book, Awakening. So, like, because I've been learning this, I realized I'd be really careful with my languages since I was a kid, and it worked really well. However, I feel there could be a numbness because I'm trying to explain everything in my head. It's like if somebody doing something I don't like, I just say, oh, that is inconvenience, like something like that. But then I realize I'm really angry about it, but I'm trying to be positive in my head.
Yes.
And then I realize there has a lot of suppressing emotions of negativities. So how am I knowing I'm purifying my energy instead of I'm just being numb and avoiding to face the real emotions?
Okay. First and foremost, I want to tell you that 25 years back, I used to speak so fast that even my parents would have to say, please say it again, we didn't understand what you said, just to speak very, very fast. And the change that has happened in the way of speaking has only happened because there's a change in the way of thinking. So I have not practiced or made any effort to talk softly or slowly. It just happened. I was not even aware when it happened and how it happened. And it's still continuing. It's a journey we're still on. Now, very beautifully, you said when a situation comes, you have learned how to say positive words. And you know, that's a big, big, big achievement. Big achievement. That here is a stimulus and I have learned how to respond to that stimulus with positive words. Because had I not learned that, and if I was not using that vocabulary, I would have been using another vocabulary. And we know what that vocabulary could be. And that vocabulary would have escalated my reaction. It wouldn't be what it is today. It would have escalated my reaction, which had would have got rebound energy from somebody else from there. And the situation would have gone to another level altogether. So it's like, immediately when my first sentence, when my first response is positive, it's solution-based. I have protected myself. Big, 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 big protection. I have protected myself. Second part, what we can do is, whenever you're sitting with yourself early morning, sit with yourself and just sit in silence and just see what are the thoughts that come to you. You know, like a physical wound. If I hurt my foot somewhere and I just put a medicine quickly and I got back to work. But then when I sit back at the end of the day, I suddenly realize it's hurting a little bit, right? But I didn't realize it during the day because I put some instant medicine and I was back to work. So when you sit in silence with yourself and just see what are the thoughts which come to you, you will know that this is your emotional pain. That means this is a wound which was created. We were very powerful and positive in our words, which is a big, big achievement. But somewhere I'm holding on to that little pain. And now what we do is you write out your thoughts of pain. Write it out. What is your mind saying? You know, it's like somebody else saying something to you. So write out those thoughts of pain. And you already have the beautiful positive vocabulary with you, right? So you know what you have to say to that. So then you also write out those positive words. And when you do that every day for 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, 6 days, do it when you're in silence. Very soon, the change that you have created in words will also become the change in your mind. Mm-hmm. And second, very important thing is take care that you don't consume that quality content. Mm-hmm. It's like I heal my mind and then I again hit my mind with some content where they're using negative vocabulary. See, what you are learning from Tony is positive vocabulary. But what you are learning from the world in terms of entertainment and content could be a completely opposite vocabulary. Now, how much time are you listening to him and how much time are you listening to other content? So what is going to happen with the mind? Which one is going more on the mind? So along with consuming positive content, we also really, really need to restrict negative content. Mm-hmm. It's like healthy diet and junk food. So if you eat healthy food one meal a day, and otherwise thrice in a day, you're consuming junk food. Which one is more powerful? Mm. So try and keep a healthy diet throughout the day. That itself will make the whole process very simple.
I would add that the questions that we've been talking about here is to question the meaning. So when you feel, it's great to give it a label initially so you don't go deeper down there, but then to ask yourself the question in these times he's talking about when you're silent, when you're quiet, you know, what does this really mean? Is this really true? Mm-hmm. The questioning of the negative thought, right? You can only, most of us doubt our beliefs and believe our doubts. And the question is to begin to ask the question, is this really true? Mm. And could it be a misinterpretation? Could this be a misperception? Do I know all that I could possibly need to know about this? Mm. And then as if you're using the format we're talking about for Byron Katie as an example, you could say, when I think this thought, how does it make me feel? Because we only stay with something as long as we feel certain consequence. How do I feel when it's there? How do I behave? How do I act? Is that really true? Is that how I want to feel? What if I never had this thought? If this thought wasn't here, what I would experience. And then those reversals, which you look at it and say, what if the opposite were true? And you look for three or four options. Because the secret is, yes, you don't want to just consume things and allow your mind to go crazy, but you also don't want to just affirm something without going to the deeper meaning. Remember, the three decisions we teach all of you is that control your whole life is, what are you going to focus on? That's what she's talking about. Whatever you focus on continuously, we said this the first day, you don't experience life. You experience the life you focus on. And there are millions of things we can focus on. What's wrong is always available, so is what's right. So it's the habit of that component. And then a second one is, what is the meaning? And can we find the empowering meaning? Not BSing ourselves, not just labeling it, but by questioning, we can get to the natural empowering meaning. And then from that, we have different emotions and our actions will change. Mm-hmm. But the same thing we noticed, it came up earlier when I was talking with the young lady over here, talking so fast. It's not just talking so fast, it's acting so fast. Learning to use those gears instead of only having one gear is what makes life great. But most people are speeding up because if they slow down, they start to feel what they don't want to feel. They start to notice what they don't want to notice. And it's like, if in the middle of your fear, you'll dive deeper into it, you'll discover it has no power over you. If you'll dive into the thing you're trying to avoid in a calm state, a centered state, over and over again, suddenly there'll be no fear because it's all imaginary. It's not real. So these daily disciplines you're sharing are so consistent with everything we've been talking about here. Whatever you feed the mind, whatever you focus on is what you're feeding it. There's so much you could be noticing in this moment. The smell of your neighbor after the jumping up and down, these beautiful words, right? This incredible soul that's in front of us sharing from our heart. There's so many things. You could be thinking about the past, the present, or the future. We do not take in all of life. We take in a very small part of life. So our responsibility, if we want to have a joyous life, if we want to be a source of pleasure and joy and happiness for others as well, is to become more conscious about that. And these times, these short times of giving yourself a chance to feed the right focus, the nutritious focus, so to speak, as well as to question the limiting meanings, it can be done during meditation, but yeah. Meditation comes in many forms. Some of you don't like the traditional idea of meditation. You could do it on a run. You could do it while you're sitting down, looking out at nature. You don't have to do it one specific way. There's so many ways, but it's just questioning the mind when it has pain or limitation, because anything that's questioned continuously, you'll start to feel there's nothing real there. Mm. But I really love Sister Shivani. You're so beautiful.
Yeah.
She acknowledged the truth. You've done the first step, and you want to own that first step that you've done beautifully. Now it's just going to the next step that'll give you more freedom. Give her a hand. Thank you so much. Right here.
So I help people break free from alcoholism, addiction, and unhealthy dependencies. And many times I do it similar to Tony, where I have to go direct. I have to, you know, it's just my style, let's say. But I want to also learn from you. How do you deal with people that are really stuck in denial? Like, you seem very not like me. So what is your way of breaking people from denial? Like, what route do you take?
Well, just the fact
denial
that
you're breaking about
shows the limitation, right? But please, Sister Shivani.
Denial about?
Let's say they don't believe that their problem is as bad. They, you know, okay. Everybody loves them. Everyone knows it's terrible, but they're not there yet.
With drugs or alcohol, for example.
Drugs, but you're there to help them break free of that. How would you do that?
Actually, when we don't talk about the alcohol or the drugs, we're talking to the soul.
Yes.
So we work on this soul healing. The soul is definitely carrying something of the past, which is not allowing them to be happy, and they're looking for that happiness somewhere outside. Unless they heal themselves internally, many are able to give up even without doing any inner healing. Of course they can, and many are able to give it up for life, a substance abuse. But that's not something that I work on, working on the addiction. We work on the emotional addictions that they've held on to, whether it is guilt, whether it is lack of self-love or lack of love for people. So we're completely working only on that. And in the process, while the soul heals themselves, they don't realize that that substance just is not needed in their life. So not working directly on substance addiction or anything, but just working on the healing of the soul, which they have to do themselves because we can't heal people. We can only share with them what we're learning about healing the self, and they will use that to heal themselves. And depending on what internal vacuum they have created, they just have to fill that space, and the need for something from outside will just automatically fall away. It's a result that happens of the emotional healing.
And would that be building that emotional immunity as well, as you've described?
Yes.
Same exact
yes.
patterns, yes. developing those yes. new patterns until they begin to take over?
Yes, because if I am not experiencing something, then I'm looking for it outside. Yes. When I start experiencing it, I will not find the need for it outside. That could be not just addiction of alcohol or drugs. It could be gadget addiction. It could be people dependency. Addictions come in a lot of ways. Attachment comes in a lot of different ways. Even attachment to me being right always. Mm. Attachment that my idea, attachment is so subtle.
Yes.
You know, very subtle. Attachment is an addiction. So once we start working on ourselves gently, all these addictions,
yeah.
the very visible ones, which the world can see, and the very subtle ones, which we know, but we didn't even know it's an attachment or an addiction. So even they start falling off.
The seed I would plant with you also is your language of breaking them from it shows that you've got a really nice hammer. You might be treating everyone as a nail. It might be. I don't think so. I'm sure you have many different tools in your toolbox. But when you come across something that's really resistant and you're really trying to help the family, I know how much you care, mm-hmm. and your intensity increases, and there's nothing wrong with that. But perhaps we need some other metaphors besides break. Yeah. And this one is more healing. This is more building. This is more creating something or awakening something that already exists within someone that they've forgotten.
And is something else to consider, Adam, the practice of recognizing their soul. If you think about it, they have an identity that they are an addict. And so there's a lot of shame around that. There's a lot of guilt around that. It's a lower identity rather than reflecting their sovereignty, reflecting that you're such a beautiful soul beyond the behavior, beyond the addiction, and to reflect that they probably haven't seen themselves possibly ever like that. And the fact that through your eyes that you recognize the purity of their being, the beauty of their being, be beyond the behavior, and hold the space from that clarity of love, I think is just such a gorgeous practice, Sister Shivani, and you're reflecting the truth of their being. I can't think of anything more profound, and that would be healing in itself and would create a space of receptivity that they would want to share and trust you and open that door to their heart to be able to have a deeper and more meaningful conversation possibly.
And it's less of a push, mm-hmm. so less push back, right? You push and there's push back. One of the things I really honor in you, Sister Shivani, is so much love but still strength.
Yes.
But it's not a push strength. Mm. It's a pull strength. Can you feel it?
Yes.
She's pulling you towards where it is because she owns it within herself. She's not pushing it on you so that you have to accept it or not. That's not where she's coming from. That's part of the power of her message. It comes from her heart, from her soul. And you have that, Adam. But sometimes when we feel like we're not getting to the level we want to help and we think it's life and death, sometimes more push happens. And I've certainly made that mistake plenty of times myself. But you're the toolbox of your heart and soul is much larger than just breaking them. And I think that might be a helpful thing to remember. And then just think of the example she just gave for the other lady here about her father. That's the exact same model. Mm. Right?
Yeah.
Remember, you're talking to a pure, beautiful soul.
Yes.
You know, we go beyond labels of even relationship, roles, positions. We're living in a world where it's a role-to-role connection. It's a position-to-position connection. It's an achievement-to-achievement connection. Or it's a relationship connection. But those are all labels that we have acquired in this lifetime.
Yes.
Connect to the soul.
Yes.
So, you know, just all the labels fall off. But that is if we are living in that consciousness ourselves. Not living in a consciousness of what we've achieved. That is there to use. That is there to work and live with. But who am I? And then connecting to who they are becomes very easy, actually. You don't have to do it. Just have to do it for the self. So what you see in yourself is only what you will see in others. If you see yourself as a gender, Your attention will go on the gender of the other person. If you see yourself as a nationality or a religion, that's what you will see in the others. If you see yourself as a qualification and a position, that's what you will pay attention to. But if you remember that you are a pure, beautiful soul, then that's what you will see the other person. And they'll receive that vibration from you.
Yes.
Yes, Jack.
Namaskaram, Sister Shivani.
Namaskar.
This is my third spiritual trip with Tony and Sage, and I've learned a lot. I've learned a lot from the speakers that have come to these events, and I've gone to a lot of their events and read their books. Recently, a lot of the universe is speaking to me about death, and I think you mentioned death as well, and Sadhguru just wrote a book about death that's sitting in my nightstand. When I get back, I'm going to read. And yesterday, we had a gentleman speaking, Mo, about how the death of his son changed his life and put him on a mission. And one thing he said that kind of stuck out to me was, his son's dream and mission in life was to impact people. And it was kind of that mission that he's continuing. And he accepted that his son's passing was, him going into the spirit, the divinity, and being in touch with everybody. And, coming from a Christian background, we're always taught, different things, and there's a little bit of conflicting values there like my grandmother passed a year ago, and for me, seeing her soul go through that journey, for me, it was a very beautiful process. But for my mother, she grieved for months, and she couldn't let go. It was a very difficult process, and again, I spoke to her soul instead of telling her, you're doing right, you're doing wrong, and she eventually released that identity and connection with her mother. But I heard you also mention that death is a difficult process, that the person that's passing is struggling. And, I wondered you, maybe if you can address that point.
Can I mention
the experience of death would depend on how we've lived our life. So if my life is a lot of attachments, then just leaving this attachment, it's like if you're wearing a very tight dress, costume, which is like clinging onto your body, then taking off is going to take a little time. But if you're wearing something which is very loose, you can just pull it off like that, right? So it all depends on how attached I am to everything and how much burden that I am carrying. If you are living a life where you are with everybody, but emotionally detached doesn't mean indifferent. Detached just means that your mind is not dependent on people and situations. Then you're living a life where you will be able to leave the body with a lot of ease. But if I'm very entangled and attached, then of course I don't want to leave the people who I'm leaving. So I am creating pain while leaving. And it's not just my pain, it's also the pain that I'm receiving from the people who I'm leaving. So that's why the soul, when they leave in that state, they are in a little pain. That's why we were all taught to pray for them. Why are we say pray for them? Why do we say rest in peace? Because we know that they may not have left very peacefully. We want them to be in peace. That's why we pray for them. But art of dying is actually art of living, and art of living is actually art of dying. So if I live my life in a way where all my karmic accounts I settle every moment, not carrying clutter and baggage, then we're ready to leave any minute. It's like people who travel often, they have their bags packed. You give them a call and they will leave. And people who are not ready, they'll say, no, wait, I need time to pack. So often we don't get time to pack before leaving the body. So it's good to keep all things sorted. And so then when you leave with gratitude and blessings, not with any pain or bitterness carrying with you. So the ease of leaving. And also for us, we also need to learn or be able to do it, the ease of letting other people leave. Mm. You know, if someone is in a state where the body is not going to heal, the doctor has also said that they cannot do anything. But sometimes we see people that the soul doesn't leave. They don't leave. They're not able to leave. So if you talk to the soul, even in cases where it's a coma, where you feel that the person cannot listen to you, but actually the soul can listen to everything that you're thinking and saying. And you gently hold their hand, talk to them, radiate a lot of love and say, don't worry about the people behind. We'll take care of your children. We'll take care of your people. A very beautiful costume is waiting for you. Mm-hmm. Just send them like you have to send somebody out of the house. You say, go, go, go. You have to go to work. And the person says, no, I want to stay with you. I say, no, no, no. You have to go to college. You have to go to work. Similarly, you have to gently send them away that, no, you have to go to your new destiny. So it also becomes easy to allow people to leave their costume.
I've experienced this myself in two different people in my lifetime, both of which yes. were in a coma for weeks and died within minutes of my having those conversations yes. twice.
Absolutely. It yeah. just takes a few minutes for them miraculous. To leave after that.
Truly miraculous. I want to mention one thing, if I may, because there are many different faiths in this room. And I heard you say that it creates a conflict in values. I would question and consider, is it a conflict in values of Christianity or a conflict in beliefs and rules?
Yeah.
Because the values of Christianity, the values of most religions, have a base in something called love or service or connectedness. It's the rules that men have made. It's the belief structures that we've been taught that come in conflict. It's important to make the distinction between values and beliefs. I don't think you have a conflict in values. I think you might just have a conflict in what the mind believes. Something just to consider.
Thank you.
Thank you. One or two more.
Thank you, Sage. Tony.
Yes.
Sister, thank you very much. Just a question about, you mentioned the young sister who had had 30 years of hate in her heart, in her mind. And, you know, I have three daughters. You know, I love them and my wife. I wanted to know your thoughts on how they're going to go through troubles in their lives, as we all do, as we all are. How valuable and how would you recommend using some form of pre-framing so that when they do have these issues, that they're already prepared and have that emotional strength and vitality to get through it, and they don't have to, you know, wait 30 years or... how would you introduce it to a, maybe not a six-year-old, but maybe, I don't know, when would you introduce these ideas? Thank you.
First and foremost, we need to remember as a parent, our thoughts and vibrations, which means our ideas are already radiating to them. The time that the soul starts absorbing your ideas and your beliefs of life are when they enter the womb of the mother. And that's why today when there is healing, a lot of people are regressed to the womb and they say, what was the parent going through when the soul was in the womb of the mother? You know, so if a parent means both, it's not necessarily just the mother, but it's both. If the parents were going through any turmoil, any conflict, any fear, any trauma, then sometimes the soul absorbs that in the womb and then they carry it in their life. But similarly, if the parent is going through self-reflection, meditation, love, compassion, the soul absorbs it right from the womb. So there is no age of when we are going to teach children. It's about what we are learning, what we are holding, what is our belief. Belief meaning understanding, not just a belief, understanding how I live in my consciousness and what's the aura that I carry. It's radiating to every soul around you. And children catch it faster, which means as I grow older and more information keeps getting coded on my mind, in which we say the ego gets developing, my ability to absorb and catch reduces. But a child absorbs very fast, very fast. So it's actually the easiest time. When they're 5, 6 years old, it's the easiest time for them to learn. But learn not by talking about it repeatedly, but learn by living it.
Yeah.
And of course, your vocabulary, you know, your way of talking to them starts becoming their way of thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Starts becoming their way of thinking. We need to learn and therefore be able to share that we are not just the body and everything that we do. We are the energy in this body. That is I, and the rest, everything is mine.
Mm-hmm.
This I and mine is very important because everything is mine. I believe it's I. So if somebody did something to my body, I don't say they did something to my body. I say they did something to me. Nobody can do anything to me. The power there only lies with me. It's the room here. That's the only place no one else can enter. So never they say they did this to me. They can't do anything to me. No one can do anything to me. So that I and mine difference is very important. And then, first and foremost, don't think that they will definitely go through all these challenges and these issues. No. Every soul comes with a different destiny, different karma, different vibrations. Don't already start thinking that they will go through this. That is also an affirmation. That's also a vibration.
Yes.
Don't send it. It's like me saying, my child will meet with an accident in this life. No. Why? Why will we ever think like that? But we think like that because we feel many people are going through it. Doesn't matter. Every soul's journey is different. So we will not create a thought that they will go through these challenges. That's also not an energy. So we are empowered. We empower them. As they go through those little things while they're 5 years old, 6 years old, from there we start the principles of cleaning the mind, forgiving, apologizing, letting go, self-respect. Self-respect should not be dependent on public approval.
Amen.
Is what we can teach them when they are in kindergarten. And especially for a generation which is growing up on social media handles right from the time when they are kids, it's a very deep conditioning that if people approve of me, then I'm good. And if people don't, then I need to change to become what they want me to be.
Yes.
So self-esteem should not be dependent on public approval.
Mm.
I should know for myself what is comfortable, what is right for me, what makes me at ease. And so as young girls, they don't need to change and become what somebody else wants them to be. Yes, they take advice. They see if it works for them. Yes. But only just so that I get more likes on my social media handles, we start changing.
Mm.
Simply start changing from the way we dress up, the way we eat, the way we speak, the way we behave. We start becoming like what the world wants us to be just to get more approval. So self-respect is what we develop. And it can start from any age.
Mm.
But more important is just about who you are as parents. Yeah. Children will just absorb it. My mother started meditation. And she used to tell me to do it. And the more she told me, I said, like, no, I'm not interested in all this. I don't need it. My life is perfect. There's nothing wrong in my life. And then she stopped saying it. And this I'm saying when I was 25 years old, not even 5 years old. And then she stopped saying it, but she was living it.
Yeah.
And the vibration was in the house. And one day I just got up and I said, I also want to learn what you're doing.
Mm.
I still don't know why I said it, actually.
Mm-hmm.
It was in the air. It's in the air. That's why I say vibrations travels faster than COVID. You just catch it and you don't even know when you caught it. There was nothing wrong, nothing had happened. I just got up one day and said, I also want to learn what you're doing. That's it. So just live it and it vibrates and radiates and they catch it.
Mm.
And everything Sister Shivani has been sharing with you is an example of priming, right? You're priming the mind with these affirmations. You're priming the mind by also what you're deciding not to consume, when you're not trying to consume it. I mean, think of everything she shared with you. It's been a form of priming. Priming the mind, the body, the heart, the soul to be at its best.
Yes.
And that starts with you. Your energy will have that impact.
And how incredibly profound for our children, once again, to reflect that they are a beautiful soul. That they are a pure
yes.
soul, reflecting their sovereignty back to them. So then they go into school, and if there's maybe a child that's a bully, once again is, you know, the recognition and awareness that they claim who they are in this world, and that they're not here to please the external world. We're here to serve the external world. And we get to raise, not only be, but also raise a generation that are aware of the fact that we're here to be a blessing to life. There's nothing more profound The fact that your soul stood up and asked that question for your children is just, it moves me. So thank you, Sister Shivani, for offering your light.
Thank you for all that you've shared with us. We worked so hard to find you. We chased you through many different locations. So we're so grateful we caught you and so grateful we got to share with you. And we hope to meet you in person sometime in the near future.
And next time you plan to come to India, please come to India, Bharat. It's a very beautiful country and I know you love that country.
And
Mount Abu is a very beautiful place of vibrations of meditation. So look forward to having each one of you over there.
Look forward to it. Namaste. Thank you very much.